Kirk, hey.
Hey, how's it going?
Good, how are you? Can you hear me and see me okay?
I can.
All right, awesome. Thanks for reaching out.
Oh, I appreciate your help.
My pleasure. So what do we got going on? We got 15 minutes, so we got to sort of get right into it.
Okay, I've got a dog that I've done a lot of showing with, and I did a lot of traveling. The dog was calm in the car, but one day I had this a slam on the brakes because a deer ran out in front of me.
Yeah.
And I used to keep a barrier so he couldn't come up front.
Yep.
And he kind of flew into that. I mean, he didn't get hurt or nothing, but now the dog's neurotic in the car.
Yeah.
I have a hard time taking him anywhere.
Yeah.
He likes to go. He jumps right in the car.
Yep.
But soon he get going. So I was trying to figure out how to fix this problem.
So what does he do? So it's typical. I mean, he had a bad experience driving, and now he's associating it with it. And it can be fixed. What exactly is he doing that's so what's the behavior that's happening that's different now?
Well, before he used to just lay down and be calm, and now he pants and rolls and shakes.
Yep.
If I use my van instead of my SUV, he'll claw at the window sometimes. He wants out of that vehicle.
Yeah. So does he know when he's lying? So when he's panting and shaking, is he in a sitting position or a standing position?
Faces a lot.
Got it. Okay. So it's really hard for us to like, I can tell you, hey, stop being nervous, Kirk. And you're like, I'm nervous. Right. But I can tell you to, Kirk, sit down at the desk, right? I can tell you to sit down at the desk. I can tell you to sit down on the couch. I can help you with your body movements before I can help you with your mind movements. So we have the same philosophy with dogs. We can't say, stop being nervous. We can't even correct nervousness at a point. I mean, excessive like pacing, but that would be correcting the body. So what I would do is I would practice downs in the vehicle. So I do the same thing with my dogs. So I've got an SUV, they're in the way back, and I've got a little gate there. I do it mostly because I just don't want, you know, fur up in the front, or I just don't want them climbing up in the front. Also, when I leave the vehicle, sometimes they would have the habit of like climbing up to the front seat, you know, like, where's Jeff? And so for me, it was the easiest thing to put that barrier. So when I'm driving and I see them standing up, I'll just say either no or down. They know no means don't be standing up, and they absolutely know down means lie down. So what I do is, and for me, I just do it so I can see out the back of my window, but I also do it because I don't need them standing up. And I know they're not in the most relaxed position as well. They're probably excited that we're going somewhere. That's their big thing. It's like, oh, are we gonna go play Chuck It or go to the ocean, or like, where are we going? So what I do is teach down in the back seat. And that's what you're going to work on. So does your dog know down under voice control from a distance?
Yes.
Excellent. So is your dog remote collar trained?
Yes.
Excellent. So there's your recipe right there. So it's going to be, and you're going to role play it. As soon as you get in the vehicle and you're in your driveway, is your dog already started that anxious behavior?
He's getting into it. He hasn't started it yet, but he's up and he's starting to pant a little.
Bingo. That's where you start. You always go to the lowest common denominator, to the easiest point. Don't wait until you're driving and you're like, your dog is already in full blown and your dog's not listening, and here you are driving. So you're driving, you got a remote, and you're checking your back mirror, and that's a dangerous situation. So what you want to do is start it in the driveway, or you can pull out of the driveway, pull in front of your house, stop your vehicle, start it then. So it'll be verbal down, or believe it or not, you can actually correct your dog / punish your dog while it's nervous, because you know that it's dangerous for your dog to be in the standing position pacing back and forth. The most comfortable position for the dog physically is going to be in a down, and then eventually that's going to follow. We see dogs all the time, over and over and over again, that are in that state of mind, maybe not necessarily in the back of a vehicle, but in a crate, standing up in a crate. And what do? Down them in the crate. What do they eventually do? Yes, they're a little bit nervous. Yes, you can tell they're nervous, but eventually, we're not talking about months. We're talking about hours or maybe a day or two, or maybe in your case it might be days or even weeks, just fall asleep. So okay. That's what I would do. That is literally what I would do, and that is what I do. So my dogs aren't nervous in the back. They're excited, but arousal is arousal. Nervous arousal or excitement arousal. So I tell them down, and what do? They drop, and then I don't see them. I don't see them until we get somewhere. And then what I do is, when I get somewhere, they have the habit of sometimes popping up. Why? They know we're getting, you know, they know where my office is. They know where we play chuck it. They know where certain areas are. I'll down them again. And then when I open up the vehicle, I absolutely want them to be in a down when I lift up the tailgate of the SUV, even though I'm in my own driveway. It's safe because it's enclosed with the fencing. If they ran out, they're not going to get hit by a car, but it's a good time to practice that, like, that calm state.
Bro, I don't let them out until I have a leash on them.
Good. So same protocol. So I would do that, and then the thing about being nervous is the dog might not listen to an obedience command. It might not even listen to a verbal no. That's where you've got to practice your remote collar no on the dog. Because what's going to happen is you got to get through all that anxiety. They don't hear down. They don't hear no. They will start hearing the remote and, well, not hearing it, but, you know, mentally hearing it. And then sometimes at a harder level, sometimes you got to go up a little bit high just to snap them out of that state of mind. The panting, though, probably won't go away right away. But you're probably not going to see the panting because the dog's dropped below the row of the seats. You might see a puddle of water. You know, I mean, the last thing I want my dog is to be anxious in a vehicle. And I can't tell you not to feel bad. Don't feel bad, though. The dog gets over it. They do get over it. They get over it. So, and I've had to stop short. My dogs have slammed up against, you know, the fence. I once got into a car accident. And actually, my dog flew from the back seat right into the front seat. I used to put my dogs in crates until it took up too much space. Some people, you know, that are watching this are going to be like, nobody sees you. They see me. They're like, oh, you should put your dog in a seatbelt. Bottom line is, you get into a car accident with your dogs, and it's a major car accident, it's going to suck no matter what they're in. So, right. You know, that's...
Well, I put him in a crate. He doesn't like that. He gets worse in a crate.
Right. And I just don't do a crate in my SUV just for... I mean, it sounds... For space. I mean, I couldn't put my second row of seats up, so that means I couldn't bring my kids anywhere. So, right. And... You know, they're going to be safe in the vehicle. They're going to be as safe in the vehicle as they are in the crate. So,
and I have two other ones that we're training, but they're quiet. I put them in a crate. They go right to sleep.
Good. Yep. So that's what I would do, and I would work on that and role play it in your driveway. So load up and then down, and then you go around to the driver's seat. As soon as you get in, if that dog's not down, focus on that down even before you. Leave, turn on the car, like take it step by step by step by step, but make sure the dog understands no with a higher correction if needed by, because you got to break through all that stuff. You have to break through all that stuff. You're going to hear a lot of advice that there's two sides. It's like, here I am telling you obedience, correct for lack of obedience. On the other side of the spectrum, someone's going to say, make riding in the car fun. You're not going to make riding in the car fun. You're not going to. That's like, oh, you know what? You don't like roller coasters, but you like barbecue ribs? Hey, get on this roller coaster and here's a plate of ribs. Like, no, like, it's not gonna work. It's not gonna work, you know? It's like, so what you have to do is you just do a lot of roller coasters. That's how you get it. You get a lot of roller coaster rides in. So it's the same thing. Your dog is not going to be. So how do we train dogs to enjoy things? We try to do positive associations with that. I agree 100%. Food, praise, toy. We do the exact same thing. But when a dog is in a state of panic, all that stuff's out the window. It's out the window. Dog won't eat. You try to praise the dog, it actually could make it worse, and you are actually making it worse. And then if it put its favorite toy back there, it won't see it. You'd have the biggest chew bone there. Now, I'm not against a chew bone. If you start breaking through that and you want to throw a toy or a chew bone back there, go right ahead. I don't care. But to get that initial, like, snap that dog out of it, the protocol that I described at the beginning is how you're going to do it.
Yeah, because his mind's in a completely different state. He doesn't listen. He doesn't. No. And if you tell him no, it gets worse.
It gets worse. So the electronics are going to help you. And sometimes at the beginning, it's not pretty. It's not pretty. So I just had a dog. I've got a dog that I don't bring on the road with me. What I mean is like back and forth to work. Every time we got home, the dog would bark. And it's not the biggest thing in the world. Dogs bark all the time when they get home. But it bothered Linda, who's in the house. So what did I do? Put a remote collar on the dog because the bark collar wasn't working right. Put a remote collar on the dog, and I kept the remote with me. So I come home. Right before I got home, I turned on the handset just to, so I didn't want to drain the battery. And I got home, and then I pull in. As soon as that electronic gate opens up, he comes out, bark, bark, bark. I correct him. It actually made him bark more at the beginning. But after 3 days of that, the dog comes out, and he doesn't bark. And now the dog sometimes doesn't even come out of, because we've got an inside-outside kennel that the dogs can go in. And now sometimes he doesn't even come out when I come home. So it took 3 days to do. But if I didn't have electronics, oh, that would have made it worse. And if I would have like come home and what? Told him to sit and reward him, he'd bark his head off like crazy if I came home. Because he's like, Jeff's home and, I know I'm going to get like food or you know, anything like that. And usually as soon as I come home, within minutes we go swimming with the dogs. So he knows I'm home for the good stuff, but you have to punish the unwanted behavior.
Okay.
So what else is going on?
My other one, I'm trying to work on release to give me like when I throw an item and yep. bring it back. And I'm having a hard time. He wants to play tug of war the whole time, but.
Okay. So anytime you teach a dog either fetch or tug, which I'm actually huge advocates of tug, even with a dog, even with a dog that bites, it's like, I'm going to teach you to bite one thing and it's going to be this tug toy. But you got to teach the out command or else you have a dog that doesn't let go of something. So with out, we use electronics as well for out. And what level? The level that motivates the dog to release it. So we use it for things that they resource guard that they shouldn't have. And I use the exact same methodology for a tennis ball or a tug toy, or, you know, if we do bite work on an arm sleeve. So we do out. So I do, I've got a word for, it's a bite command. So I've got a bite command word, but you can just say take it or, well, it doesn't make a difference what you say to the dog, you can get it or any, you make up a word. You can say, you get them to tug and you wrestle with them, let them have it. And then you can get them to release it without, you use the remote. How high enough that the dog goes, puh, pick it up, do it again. They'll get it. Sometimes the first time you do it, depending on the drive of the dog, they're like, I'm not picking that up again. Don't worry. If they don't do it today, they'll do it tomorrow. And then eventually they realize it's a game. Because the way that the dog works is if you're trying to get it out of their mouth by pulling it, it's natural for the dog to bite down harder. That's how protection is done, is like how you get a dog to like bite down harder is you try to get it away from them, you get them to bite it down harder, and then you praise them for that. So, you know, other than a correction to release, that's what you do. And it's great. It's a wonderful, out is like, that's a very important command for dogs, and especially that either grab stuff that they're not supposed to or that you play tug of war with.
Right, okay, that'd be good.
Yeah, so try that. That's good. So what, do you have three dogs?
I actually have six, all German Shepherds.
Oh, really? Where do you live?
I live in southern Iowa. I have 84 acres.
Oh, my gosh.
I've had Shepherds since I've been a baby. And
nice.
I've got one here at work with me, the one that has a hard time in a car.
Oh, okay, great. Yeah, it looks like you're at work because you got a fire alarm behind you, unless you've got a high, you know, that doesn't look like it's at home, so.
Yeah, I'm a technology director. I do all the computers and servers and that kind of thing.
Nice, and you can bring your dog to work.
Well, in the summer, there's nobody here, so.
Oh, got it. That's wonderful. So that's great. You can practice this a lot then. So that's really, really great. And again, just, you know, start it out slow and don't, with this, don't expect the panting to go away right away. But I'm telling you, when you move the body somewhere, the mind follows. It happens all the time. It happens with human beings too. There's a great book out there. Well, there's a theory, cognitive behavioral therapy, CBT. So there's CBT for dummies. And it just talks about it's geared towards humans, but there's an application, if you think about it, you can use it for dogs. And it just pretty much says, you're struggling with something and you keep doing the same repetitive physical behavior, change the physical behavior, and then the mental behavior will change as well. So pretty interesting stuff. All right, anything else?
No, I think that's it.
All right. Well, Kirk,
I appreciate your help.
Oh, thanks for reaching out. I appreciate it. Yep. All right.
I love the videos.
All right, thank you so much. Take care. All right. Bye-bye.